Hello and welcome to Hey, I Loved That Movie, the podcast where we rewatch the films we loved when we were younger to see if they still hold up. I'm Dan.
I'm Michael.
And I'm Helena.
And for this episode, we have special guest. It's Elle from Check This Out.
Hello!
Elle, what movie have you brought for us today?
I have brought for you the gift of The Elm-Chanted Forest.
My first question is why?
Yeah, how? What? So you're Australian?
That's what they tell me, yes.
And you grew up in Australia?
Yep.
How did you end up watching a Czech USSR animated film?
Back in the day, my grandfather had a garage sale that I found out later that my cousins had donated half the stuff to, and I ended up buying some. There was also, in the very bargain bin section, a double pack of The Elm-Chanted Forest and Madball's Escape from Planet Orb.
Wow. Did you pick The Elm-Chanted Forest for us to watch?
Yes, because it actually has a structure and is enjoyable to watch.
Mm. First question. Is it enjoyable to watch?
I mean, I would have thought so.
So did you watch this a lot as a kid, or...?
Not really, no. I did watch it a couple of times, but it never really, like, stuck with me. And then I remember going on random, like, YouTube dives and finding it, like, with my brother. It's just like, hey, yeah, remember this? Let's watch this. It looks bad.
So, yeah, always a good sign when a film is available free on YouTube in its entirety.
In multiple parts, because the YouTube upload limits back in the day were not good.
Yeah, but someone has taken the time to put the whole movie back on there.
In glorious 480p.
With the amazing... We should say we did watch the English dub of this, not the original.
The American dub.
The American dub, yeah.
Very American. Which brings up a first problem of... I think a lot of this film is lost in translation, but I don't know what that translation is.
No.
I can't pass
not.
Out the translation.
So I'm going to try and be brave with this, because I did look up the original names. So The Elm-Chanted Forest is also known as Shudesna Shuma, which is based on a kid's book of Painter in the Forest by Shunshana Skrinjevic.
Yep.
It was apparently a very well famous like kids author in Croatia.
Mm.
Okay.
Yeah.
So famous that it was picked up by a Czech studio.
Yeah. They clearly had a lot of plans for the entire series because they named it after the whole premise. Fantasy Forest films. They had high hopes.
Yeah, they aimed high. They achieved it. No. No, they did not.
No. This movie felt like obviously with the dub, to me this movie felt like a bunch of bad improv actors trying to get through something.
That's so true.
Yeah,
that's like 100% what it is.
Yeah, because there's so many like bits in this film and like one-liners that don't really land, and
none of them feel like they're talking to each other. Like,
yeah.
It's not conversation.
Yeah, it's lines delivered in a studio.
Yeah.
I got...
Yeah, which is why I think it was mistranslated.
Yeah, it must have been.
It's
that one Whose Line Is It Anyway game where they watch just random footage and try to just fix up the dubs. It's like, what are they saying? Let's just make stuff up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I feel like maybe, and this feels even more possible now, this was translated from Croatian into Czech. And then translated into English by someone who spoke neither language.
Probably by way of French or something.
Yeah, either like French through French or German. This was like what... Have you ever played the Google Translate game?
Yeah.
Yeah, was it Translate Party? That used to just feed things back through like Japanese 10 times?
This is what that film felt like. Which, it could, because it's borderline surreal. Like, it's not surreal enough to be like Alice in Wonderland.
Yeah, it's not kooky.
Yeah, it's just weird. It's just borderline.
It's just, yeah, like you get the animals are all alive, which the scale of those animals is completely off.
Very
you get
wrong.
A fucking big beaver, or as he calls it, a beast in the bush, which is, you know. There's a bear. There's a fox that all the other animals want to fuck.
It's got a real fur. Yeah, introduction to furries.
The main bad guy is a clown demon cactus.
It's a cactus.
Yeah. Emperor Spine. I was glad that they leaned into the cactus thing, because I saw him and I was like, is he a cactus? And then I was quite pleased that I had recognised him as a cactus.
How did you go with all the puns?
I didn't hate them.
Kids film fair. Like, yeah.
I've got to have something to keep the parents mildly amused. It was so the animation style is very much rip-off Disney and rip-off Looney Tunes. Like, there are some direct, like, tracing going on of, like, these are... It's like, oh, spot the Disney characters. Spot Woody Woodpecker features in it quite heavily at one point.
Spot how many times they just use the same animation on loop a couple of... for a few...
Disney, that's not
something that people do because animation's expensive.
But that's they do Disney it a little bit heavy-handedly in this. Yeah. I don't know if we've just got high expectations or if we're judging this a little bit harshly for a film that came out...
1986.
I don't know, man. It's not exact like Snow White did it better.
The animation had oddly synchronized moments as well. It's like it wasn't enough that they were repeating it. It's just like
they were half a second of it on delay. The same slides.
Yeah. That's that. If you watch a lot of to be fair, if you watch a lot of old Disney animations, they do the same thing. Like so many Disney characters are like traced versions of old characters. It's just time saving.
Yeah.
I don't know what they were saving time to make.
No, because that's
a sequel.
That's not the bad part.
That's what they were saving time for. That's what they were saying. Because they didn't put that time anywhere else in this film. It's not like they were like, we'll make the script better by saving time on animation. No.
Sequel is The Magician's Hat or Chorobnikov Sheshir. Anyone who has problems with my pronunciation, please feel free to email in. I will definitely read all of them.
Yeah. We'll forward them to you.
We'll make sure you get them.
I mean, don't do that. That's not nice.
I'm sure all of the people who have a deep love for the Elm Chanted Forest series, they'll find us. There's not many podcasts that have watched this, I assume.
No, that's true.
So the plot, loosely, is... a guy that looks French but isn't goes and falls asleep under a tree, an elm tree, and becomes elm chanted.
Before we learn that the forest is overrun by evil. It's overrun by evil. There's no end to that sentence. Yeah, it's just been overrun by an evil cactus and the forest is cursed?
Maybe.
Well, there's these weird shimmery... things that seem to happen every now and then.
Hmm.
But other than it seems fine.
Yeah, I think the forest is cursed, and he's meant to be the hero. He's like the legendary...
There's a prophecy.
...prophetic hero. Yeah, and he's the painter
gonna
of the forest.
He's going to paint... Run the forest is going to run with paint, and the Cactus King is going to bloom.
Yeah, that's pretty much it. With the best character being the beaver, obviously.
The what? Did you say... Oh god, that pissed me off. Made me wonder, is there something lost in translation with the whole and the cactus blooms thing? Like, is that more nuanced or subtle or a play on words in a different language?
Cactus do grow.
Yeah, they do bloom, but they don't do anything. It's not like it means anything else than that. So it's like, oh, the cactus is going to bloom. Yeah,
I guess
they're going to make
like...
him bloom. It felt like maybe that means bloom and something else in a different language so that they could interpret it. It was like a clever way of interpreting it, whereas for us it was like the only way you could interpret it.
Yeah.
So it kind of
maybe
tells you exactly what it's going to do and then does it.
Maybe if like because it blooms, it softens, it gets nicer when a cactus blooms.
I think
that
because
might be
it was
sort of...
like the hopes of Cactus King will flower. Like, oh, you could interpret that as being successful or literal flowers.
Yeah. It's weird. So much of this film is like that.
But it what also doesn't make sense is that, and I can't believe I'm picking holes in this film because unraveling this is like...
We'll be here for hours.
If that's not a bad thing, why is he like being told your plans will flower? Why are you so against this prophecy? He is just kind of evil for evil's sake.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's
kids film.
Well, yeah, which is fine. but yeah.
Lives in a nice, scary, spiky castle about two frames away from the elm tree.
Yeah,
like... yeah. You do get like, oh, I wonder where. I reckon I know where the bad guys live.
Yeah.
It was very. So we watched the Cauldron. I don't know what's it called.
Black Cauldron.
Black Cauldron. Was wondering, is this the same experience for you guys?
Because... So I fully understand why you think the Black Cauldron is good now.
Yeah, I'm
but
sorry.
Only in comparison to this film. Very similar.
When I was like criticizing this in my head, I was like having flashbacks to discussing the Black Cauldron yeah. with you guys, and you making the exact same criticisms about the best film in the world.
Yeah, yeah. This is the good version, the bad version of the Black Cauldron, which is impressive because the Black Cauldron isn't good.
So if we try and go through the plot, the cactus then, first he gets a bear, and then he sets fire to the forest, the painter puts out by drawing some rain clouds, and then he floods the forest, which the painter puts out by painting a sun so scorching hot it evaporates.
The miss the best part where the world building in this film is fascinating.
Yeah.
The beaver's got the best voice actor because the ticking noises are great. Yeah, there was something really satisfying when he talked. It was great. I wish more characters would talk like that.
Oh, well, apart from the fact that it takes him 5 seconds to start talking because he has to clock and talk for the first few seconds every time he speaks. Yeah. What did the beavers do to the Cactus King? That's what I want to know, because he hates them. He really, really hates them. Best line of the film, Cleaver the Beaver.
Yeah.
Because they're builders and creators, and apparently that is everything that evil is not.
Beavers create, cactus kings destroy.
Cactuses destroy things. That's how cactuses are. Unbloomed cactuses.
I suppose
cactuses.
He's one of the few creatures that could survive the hellscape that he creates by washing and then frying this.
Surely they'd be... like allies, because you know cactuses thrive in dry environments and beavers like to build dams to stop water coming through. So if they can, like, you know, I'm sure if they work together.
But he very casually mentions that he had them all executed apart from this one beaver that got away.
Casual, it's hard to catch him. You could only have to listen to him talking. I mean, casual genocide in kids film is not as rare as you'd think it is. It turns up a lot in kids film.
So what does he have? Like, were they called spine ticklers or
tinglers?
Tinglers, which are just pikes with legs.
Yes.
The weapon.
I couldn't work out why they were his ally. Like, why they were his allies, because they were just walking weapons.
It was
why
like instead of soldiers, like... oh, that would be too aggressive. I thought, oh, maybe it's like, oh, that would be too scary or too aggressive, because you know, like how they had to cut everything from the Black Cauldron, but.
But they
show like quite a scary monster towards the end.
Yeah, but like cactus theme, you'd think like he's caught there. You'd
there
think like
there's seemingly
small
no
cactuses.
Reason. But then I was thinking, is this like the Black Cauldron where there's a lot of things for no reason, and you find out because it's based on a book that no one read?
Probably.
Yeah.
It sounds like it's based on a book that maybe some people read.
In Croatia.
But you'd just think there'd be small cactuses.
In the original book, Peter Pallet was an orphan who got kicked out of town for ruining an old lady's table. No further information given.
I hope he painted it badly, like that Jesus painting where someone tried to refurbish it.
If you look at his first painting before he gets the magic, he's an absolute dog shit artist.
He is. He's awful.
And he also...
That's why he got kicked out.
Yeah.
He painted that old lady.
He painted Jesus wrong on a table.
the actual, like, the way they do the magic painting as well isn't really, no one really seems particularly perturbed by the fact that the paintings move.
Mm-hmm.
And he just sort of puts the brush on the paint and it just sort of
magically
copies them.
Yeah, it's too much to animate if you're trying to actually animate someone painting something. It's it's his magic brush that...
So his magic that he got from the Elm-Charted Wood makes his brush magic and also makes him able to speak to these animals and for them to understand him.
And he has to make the Cactus King bloom by the next morning or he'll lose his powers. Or
no, he'll lose his powers anyway, but he won't be able to help them very much if he can't talk to them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or do magic.
But then conveniently, because he doesn't want to tell them for, you know, drama, the Cactus King has the executioner robot of death with a spike roller to come and kill everyone.
Yeah, because
he can only launch at sunrise.
Yeah, because burning the forest and flooding the forest doesn't work.
Why is the Emperor so hell-bent on destroying his own property?
Raising the land rates.
He's not trying
real
to...
Real salt the earth kind of...
Trying to destroy... He's just trying to get those creatures out. I guess he thinks he can regrow the forest and have it to himself.
To be cactuses instead, and then he'll get like little lizards or something.
Then he can have actual cactus allies instead of walking swords.
Oh man, is this the prequel to that film Rango?
this film, yeah. I'm trying to like parse out the difference between kids' film and bad. There are three things going on in this film. It's like it's a kids' film, so some of it's going to be a bit bad and obvious and like badly written. It's translated from a different language with probably very specific cultural touchstones, and it's a cheap animated film from like the 80s. We have to try and parse out which one of those things is what, because I don't know
bad or not. It's just like, so why is this bit
what
bad
part
why
of is this bad? Bit bad and is it okay that it's bad? So, do we just not understand it?
Much like the beloved The Black Cauldron, there is a absolute menagerie of different creatures and characters for us to sort of speak to. Every time you think there's a sidekick, there's a new sidekick.
Yeah.
Works for some films.
Not for this one.
There's too many. Too much going on.
Mikey, and... out of the three things that you mentioned, which one's responsible for racist mushrooms?
I think all three.
Yeah.
I think that's one of those rare things where it might be all three.
Because it's the blackface mushroom scene. We were warned. Did you understand it was bad when you watched it as a kid?
No. I mean, to be fair, you had primetime TV doing it as well and just everyone laughing it off.
Oh god. Yeah.
They got punished for that when they tried to redo it recently, which is good.
Wait, what?
Hey Hey It's Saturday is a variety show here, what was in Australia, and they had blackface on every now and then, no big deal. And when they tried to relaunch in, 2015 or something like that, their first act was blackface, and it got basically universally booed.
Yeah,
rightfully so.
That was a good idea.
Because it's like, oh, it's a throwback to one of our classic acts. Let's bring him on again.
Yeah. Just a throwback to racism.
Oh, wow. Because we had that over here. We had like a lot of TV shows that did blackface and stuff like that. But no one ever tried to do it again. People that did it actively defend that they did it. And they're like, oh, it's not my fault. It's over the time.
Well, it's all like the minstrel show stuff and all that too.
Yeah. But they never tried to bring it back, I don't think. I don't think we've had anyone
Not successfully, thankfully.
No.
But this film, I thought, because, Elle, you did let me know, there, just so you know, and you said blackface scene, so there's the first bit where the mushrooms are like, they sort of sing a little bit, and then they go away, and I'm like, oh, okay, that was bad, but it was short, that's fine, we can move on, we just mention it in the podcast, be like, obviously this is not okay, and then but then they come back and do a proper musical number, and it's like, why?
Yeah.
Is he like tripping on mushrooms? Was that kind of the point of that bit?
Isn't he sleeping? It's Neptune, isn't it? I hate that. I remember his name.
This is as Peter is kidnapped by mushrooms and is implied to be turning into a mushroom.
Right.
So I assume it's probably some hallucinogenics involved.
I assumed that he would just die and become mulch and then become mushrooms. The Neptune bit, Mikey, is when he is when the cactus guy wants to flood the forest. And that scene actually has my favourite line of the entire thing, which is beauty rest, he'd have to sleep for 1,000 years.
They're real harsh on that ugly frog fucker.
It's definitely a choice of vocalizations that he's making then to do the wobble. Because he's not like inherently just doing; he's purposely moving his head around.
He was gargling some water or something as well at the time. Like they're very much like, right, we need you to do a frog voice, and he's like, "What do you mean?" He's like, "I don't know. What what do you think? And he's like,
even in character, he's like purposely moving his big jowls around as he's talking. It's like, you are making this sound happening.
Yeah.
You are not just, it's a lump in your throat or something. You are doing this because you want to.
So, my favourite line is slightly earlier in the film, Dan, and that is when the Cactus King is talking to the fire god, demon, spirit, I guess.
No
and
one
we
knows.
Have the line, what could be more beautiful than a forest fire?
Yeah.
Oh, and also, grew up in Australia.
Yeah.
accidents with fire can be prevented if you're
careful.
Oh, yeah,
they were definitely added afterwards. They were like, no, you have to put in something about not starting fires because we will get sued.
See, my favourite line out of the entire thing is like right at the beginning. And it's Baron Burr, who's supposed to be the prophet, the soothsayer.
Oh, yeah, he's like this little bouncy jester thing.
Yeah, comes right up to Peter as he's speaking, as he's sleeping, and just yells at him, "It is the painter!" It's like, go on, mate. He's having a nap. Let him be.
Wake him up. He deserves, like, the prophecy is here, and he's the only one that can stop the cactus for some reason.
Yeah, lay about.
But also spends half the day painting portraits.
Yep.
Yeah, there's a lot of sort of hurry up and then stop hurrying up in this film.
Yeah, there's a few scenes where the animals just go to the pub.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I quite liked that, though. There was definitely like a sort of sense of community in this forest.
Yeah, I mean, apart from the wiggly lines every so often, it honestly seems like the animals weren't having that bad of a time.
That implies that without humans anyway, they're still talking and singing to each other and going to the pub.
Yeah, it's just whenever sex with the French fox.
Yeah, and then whenever someone comes along, it's just
yeah.
There's a lot of implications in this. Like, there's implications that there is a powerful overlord of each thing, because you have the cactus overlord and the fire overlord and the water overlord.
And the mushroom overlord.
The mushroom overlord. There's an implication that there is like an evil version of all of these. Do they have their own? Are that like part of the series of books? Are they all like?
Well, I think that's why the sequel's the Ice Dude, isn't it? So probably. I wasn't sure how long it was going to go for, because we had water, we had fire,
it did
then
feel
water.
Like that.
Then I was
is
the next thing going to be air, and then Earth?
Tornado, and then
I don't know, some sort of like a tornado that could just fuck shit up again, and then
you didn't have air, you had bear as the first one.
Yeah, that bear is a direct ripoff of the
Baloo.
Croatian Baloo.
It's such like a sidestep. It's not even necessary. It's just Thistle, the king's a magician.
Just happens
to come across the bear, and it's like, well, okay, I'll give you a hand. You can help me. This is
he gets
a complete coincidence.
And then it's like, okay, now I'll help you. By the way, my name's Buddy Bear, and I'm an old, aging athlete. It's like, okay.
Yeah. We've forgotten about the witch.
Yeah, Thistle, right? Yeah.
Oh, yeah, Thistle, yeah. The traffic cone.
Yeah.
He has the best music
in this movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What was up with that whole thing? I'm finding it so. It's like I'm trying to remember this film, and my brain is actively.
It's like trying to remember a dream while you're telling someone about it.
I finished watching this film 3 hours ago, and it's like my mind is trying to forget it.
I watched it yesterday, and I'm like, there's big gaps.
All I remember is the cactus guy shouting "Pinhead." The fact that I think all of the evil, big evil people were voiced by the same guy trying to do different voices, that's kind of what it felt like. I don't know if it's true, but definitely when the water guy and the cactus were talking to each other, I think that's why he's putting on such a watery voice, because that's just the same dude.
Yeah, you're not wrong, actually, because this has just gone to a dubbing studio.
Agent.
Yeah. And they're like, how can we do this as cheaply as possible? Have two people.
Yeah, have two people, everyone do the same.
The Skyrim effect.
But less the included lines of, oh, sorry, I messed that up, can I do it again?
Yeah.
they never took that out. Like, they had a chance to afterwards as well when people found it. It's almost as good as when the water guy in this film shouted, "If it's water you want, it's water you'll get." Then just sprayed the dude.
Yeah.
What happens in the end of this film? Because I'm now like, oh, at the end of the Black Cauldron is in my
head.
Have
to get, they have to like gather loads of herbs and make a potion. Yeah.
Which they do in one cut. They don't have to go and get it. But during that time, that's when the painter falls in a racist mushroom hole and the witch gets sent to prison.
Yeah.
Yeah, yep. The Pikes take the witch to prison.
And they have to rescue them using a mole. And
yeah, they get a mole to dig, and they're very. It does a very like educational thing of being like, "Mole, you have bad eyes, but we need your other skills, which are heightened." It's like, yeah, he's Daredevil.
You two could just be making this up, and I would not be able to tell what.
Do you not remember the mole?
No,
he's in it for like at least 3 seconds.
Yeah, this is what I mean by it feels like an improv team trying to just think of a story on the fly. Like,
yeah, we've got to get them, and they're underground. Oh yeah, because they get told basically, they're like, "Oh shit, the wizard and the painter haven't come back from gathering their flowers yet. That's weird." And then spiky prophecy guy comes up and is like, "Haha, one of them dwells in the ground, and the other one's in the cellar." I'm sitting there like, "Those were both underground, dickhead."
I took like a page of notes of this film, more than a page of notes. I don't remember any of this.
You spent more time writing than you did listening.
Apparently. I don't remember any of this.
So they have to go and rescue them. So they leave the beaver to carry on finishing off the potion while they rescue them, because they have to basically rescue them and then get the emperor to drink the potion before the next day.
That I don't remember anything else. I blacked out. I think I blacked out.
And they do it in a much better way in the book too. From looking it up.
They don't just pour it in his open mouth while he's asleep. It'd
be pretty hard for them not to.
Yeah, it was because anticlimactic.
Apparently it's a dwarf that brews the potion, not Thistle.
They missed the opportunity to have another random character in this film. Yeah. Oh my god, it sounds like I'm criticizing the Black Cauldron. It's not fair.
But Emperor Spine is torturing Thistle, and Peter goes up with the potion. It's like, "Oh, I've brought you a great gift for someone as wise and benevolent as you." And the king just goes, "Well, no, you're up to a trick. I don't want it." It's like, "Okay, well, I'll give it to your wizard instead. He'll love it." It's like, "No, wait, no, I want it. He can't have it. Drink, drink, drink."
Oh, okay, yeah, proper bit of subterfuge.
That does sound a lot better than he's asleep, pouring in his mouth when he wakes up and sees you.
Yeah.
Yeah, because it sort of takes away, it does undercut this whole, like, he's a terrifying, violent overlord, but they manage to creep up on him while he's asleep.
Mm-hmm.
They do trip over all of his axes, and I mean all of them.
Yeah.
And the beaver eats them?
Maybe.
In a shot?
Yeah,
he chews through the shaft.
Oh my god, he's cutting these people in half, because they have little legs. I thought they were just sort of bobbing along, sort of like the in Fantasia, the brooms in the magician's apprentice.
Yeah,
I thought they were like that, but then I realised that actually no, it's just that I'm watching the incredibly lo-fi YouTube cut of this film.
Yeah,
and it was only in certain shots I could see the little legs at the bottom. So he just chews through their bodies. Too. I saw the faces, yeah, but I just thought they were like bobbing along on a stick and just held up by magic.
Hmm.
I think that's something that it reminds me of as well with the comparison to Fantasia, because there are like orchestral numbers that go on for too long. But it's like, well, we have this
and it's
music.
So bitty. It's so like clip show-esque in that there's just no real good continuity in a lot of the shots.
Yeah, and it's just like, here is an excuse to pad the animation out by putting this music in.
Yeah, we have to hit that hour and 20-minute runtime somehow.
It only just gets to feature-length film status, and you can tell,
Thank God. Thank God it
only
just
got. I'm glad.
To be honest.
So they feed the Emperor the potion, he becomes all flowery, and all of his spikes become flowers, and then they...
And they forgive him for the genocide.
And so he makes a peace and feeling good festival, in which there is a gratuitous ass shot of the fox. Because, of course,
isn't that before? Because she then beats up the soldiers.
I
yeah, yeah, she's got a veil on.
to help them get past the soldiers to get into the king's castle.
Because they want to fuck the fox as well.
Flaunts herself past them, dressed as like there's like faintly Arabian Nights music kind of playing, and she does a little boogie, and then her foxtail beckons for them to come and join her in the woods, and they all run in, and then she attacks them all.
Because it's in the festival where she offers for the bear and the beaver to spit roast her.
You know, as you do.
Yeah. I mean, I it's not that I don't believe you.
Every single animal and people in this movie want to fuck that fox.
Oh yeah, no, she knows it as well. That's what's weird. The weird vibe is that she's like, look, when she first introduces us, I was like, look, you're a painter. You need a muse. She has to be sexy because that's what muses are. And don't you agree? I'm fit as fuck. And he's just like, yeah, let's paint.
She gets away with so much because of her looks.
It's not a good message to send out.
Everyone else is fighting over their position in line to get their portrait painted. She just jumps the queue. No one has any issues.
She's also, I think, the only female character. Is the witch a female? I have no idea.
Thistle is a male.
It's hard to tell.
Thistle is pretty gender non-specific in this.
There's also the mother of the hedgehogs, who are based off a musical scale.
Yes, Do, Re, no, Re, Mi, and Fa, or something?
Fa and La are the mother and father, and then Re, and Mi are the triplets.
I don't even remember these hedgehogs.
They were brightly coloured. I mean, for hedgehogs.
Yeah.
That doesn't help with this film.
They did choose pretty seemingly random colour palettes for each animal.
Yeah. If it helps as well, the beaver does turn around the spit roasting because instead it walks off and sees another female beaver.
No, I remember that. There was a female beaver.
So, and then the painter...
Not good at genocide is what we learned about the cactus.
So the other thing that happens is that the giant spike roller that the executioner, that basically called the guillotine guy, like the robot... His spike roller and himself turns into a Ferris wheel.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, is that a trap? I'm not going to be the first person to get on a Ferris wheel that was immediately beforehand a murder weapon.
I like that the magic is so strong that it can alter the very architecture of the castle and change the machine into a Ferris wheel, but leaves the servants perfectly fine.
Yeah.
Like he still has his soldiers to do the fanfare and everything. It's like, why aren't you flowers?
I guess they look more regal though, don't they? Rather than scary.
I don't know. I think they were just little goblins.
Yeah, they didn't change.
That implies, honestly, what that implies is that they're not from that kingdom.
No, they're people that he's enslaved, probably, or they just worship him. Who fucking
it implies
knows?
That they're contractors.
Yeah.
He got some contract mercenaries in, and now they're just kind of stuck with a nice, peaceful warlord until their contract runs out. That's how what I'm thinking about them, because they didn't change.
And, like, on the subject of music, when they have the forest fire, it's a very odd choice, because it sounds very heroic and, like, adventurous. Like, well, this is a good thing.
Yeah, it all sounds very out of place, like... It seems like in the translation they also maybe just like dropped the audio files and they went everywhere and then you just kind of scooped them back up and were like, I'll do.
Yeah.
There's no order to it.
Like all the files went missing.
Mm. And the really annoying crow gets their comeuppance at the end.
Yeah.
He was one of my favourites.
Together, which is like quite mean.
It's weird that the creatures following the cactus's orders get punished.
Yeah.
Whilst the cactus just gets to become good. That's weird.
It's the whole movie is weird, to be honest.
Weird lesson to teach.
At this point, I'm just curious as to what the ratings are going to be for this. So, out of 10, how many different species want to bang that fox?
Oh, all of them. Every single species to ever exist.
Hell, do you want to go first? Because you've actually got nostalgia for this movie, so maybe it'll be...
Have nostalgia for this movie?
How are you feeling about this?
Obviously the mushroom scene hits a little bit different now that I actually know what words are and whatnot.
Mm-hmm.
But it still holds up, I think. I don't know. Would you consider the extended ending any different?
The book ending?
Yeah. So at the end of the movie, Peter just goes, yeah, I'm not magic anymore. I'm going home.
Yeah.
The book then goes on that he takes the paintings that he's done and puts them up in a gallery, and everyone shits on them for being too childish and, like, ridiculous. So eventually the exhibit closes and some kids, like, find their way in and they're like, hey, these are pretty good. We can't do anything with them, though.
Children.
Yeah. And then so I guess it's assumed that Peter has, like, that marginal short amount of success and then just goes on with no future and no talent because we've seen it.
Yeah, I guess that would give him more of a person. Like, he does kind of just, in the film, he does kind of just turn up in the forest and then leave. It'd be nice to have a bit of why he's there and why where he goes after. Probably make it a bit better. Although I don't want this film to run any longer. So if we can cut a bit out, that'd be grand. Yeah. Add that in, sure. Don't want it to run any longer, though. We can get rid of the sexy fox as much as possible.
Yeah, but would you rather have the sexy fox or the racist mushrooms?
About the get rid of the racist mushrooms. You can get rid of the racist mushrooms.
So for a rating then, I think I would have to give it 6 cactus taints out of 10.
Wow.
Jeez Louise. I just feel like we didn't watch the same film.
I feel like this is the rose-tinted glasses of nostalgia are more like binoculars in this.
The blinkers of nostalgia, yeah. It's, oh man, I just...
I mean, I'll admit to that, probably.
I guess this is your Black Cauldron, because there's... Oh, man, it's...
Now you know what it feels like, huh?
I do, and I'm bewildered, because it is just so weird. But then all the criticisms I made about this film, apart from, obviously, thankfully, there are no racist mushrooms in the Black Cauldron.
Yeah.
That we know of.
They might have been cut, to be fair. Everything else was from that movie, so... Yeah, I really didn't enjoy this film, and I was quite relieved when it ended.
I think what I found frustrating
was it has that guy that tells you what's going to happen in very easy, clearly translated badly riddles. Yeah, there was no suspense, and it didn't do it does what it says it's going to do, but it does it in the most obvious way as well. So there's not even like vague surprise at like what is going to happen, and there's no cute pigs, so. You know, no. Black Cauldron at least has a cute pig in it.
There are some big beavers, though.
Yeah. I don't know. I've got to give this, like, 3...
Oh, that's high.
Oh, no.
It's just me being polite. I quite like Thistle, but I'm going to give it, 3 cute hedgehog triplets out of 10. I will never watch this again.
No.
Yeah, fair.
And it's a bit late in the day to be having that much blackface. Yeah. I don't know. Yeah.
It was, difficult watch to say the least, considering... So I watched this at about 10 o'clock in the morning. And I'd say that was the wrong time to watch it, but I think any time.
There's definitely not a right time. I've been watching some clips, and there's definitely just some things that have been leafed out of Aristocats.
Yeah.
Like pretty much in its entirety, whenever anyone's playing instruments.
I was sitting there watching it, and I was like, this is dragging how long's left, and it had been 15 minutes. I really did not enjoy this. I remember being
so upset when people didn't like the Black Cauldron.
I am very well known for having bad taste.
That's fair enough.
I just let it ride. It's cool.
Honestly, my score, as written down, is one apology I owe to Helena about the Black Cauldron.
Oh, so at least this, the Black Cauldron's better than this film, right? Right?
Yeah.
But that's not a high standard. That's a low bar to jump.
Well, fine.
It is a very low bar. Because, I'll give this... Because I want to give it a 1, but I refuse to give it a 1. Because 1 is reserved for very, very specially kind of bad. 2? I can't. I honestly can't. My brain... It's like a traumatic thing happened, and my brain is trying to stop me from remembering it.
Two actors total that did the voicing?
Yeah, no. Two evil warlords voiced by the same person trying to sound as different as possible,
yelling at
each other.
If it helps, in the dub, it doesn't say who voiced who, but one of the actors does have the surname of Forrest, so...
No, that was
entertaining.
Made for the role.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's the most entertaining part is the IMDb page.
Yeah.
Oh dear.
One voice actor doing two voices is bad. This film's bad is about the. And it's better than. It's worse than the Black Cauldron, but like, that's not exactly a good thing. That's not exactly like most films are better.
Have you seen the Black Cauldron now?
No, but it has been on my list for quite a while.
Imagine this film, but like slightly more coherent.
Mythical such a thing exists.
There's more
slightly
humans.
More coherent.
Yeah, I mean, I think what I'm gathering is if you gave this a 6, you'd probably give Black Cauldron a 10.
Yeah,
I think you'd love Black Cauldron.
Or you'll see Black Cauldron as a horrible ripoff of this movie.
Yeah, and just like review bomb it into the ground.
Yep. Oh, don't worry, Disney already did that.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of the reviews that I've seen are people who have watched it in its original language and they're saying how good it is.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what I mean. So, yeah. Like, I think it's completely lost in translation. I think so much of this film is missing.
Yeah.
Maybe we need to watch the subtitled version.
Or not.
This has a lot of 10-star reviews on IMDb.
Yeah, nostalgia is powerful.
On Letterboxd, it's got quite a lot as well.
I imagine in the original language it probably makes a lot more sense. And it's probably quite nice to watch because the animation, although it's sometimes like copied, is quite nice. It's Western animation, I love that. So
the fire scene where the forest catches fire is really beautifully animated.
Yeah.
And then there's a lot of stuff where, yeah, like the backgrounds are beautiful hand painted, like forest scapes.
Well, I mean they did tell you that in the movie. It's like, what's more beautiful than a forest fire?
it's got some really beautiful bits, but then it's got some absolute trash animation in it as well.
Yeah.
I've just been reminded about the Venetian lizard. Do you guys remember
the gondola? The gondola singer.
Oh yeah,
the gondola
singing
lizard.
And the like in the bit at the beginning, either my TV was fucking up or that's genuinely how they showed the curse in the forest. Because it looked like...
It just looks like someone's kicked your TV.
Yeah, it looks like someone's just punching the side of an old TV.
we didn't mention as well, other favourite thing. The water kingdom lord emperor sleeps on a waterbed that's clear and has fish in it.
Yeah, that is not a suitable environment for fish. Obviously.
That is a completely suitable environment for fish. He is the fish lord.
Good point.
They should be privileged.
He would know.
Yeah. Yeah, he would know more than you. He is the fish lord.
Only serial killers use waterbeds.
Well, I guess with that, I have been Dan.
I have been Michael.
I've been Helena.
No, I've been Elle.
And Elle, where can people find you?
I do a podcast that is called Check This Out. Where people review their media interests for the sake of getting people interested. And I am also a member of an actual play group, Final Show Films. We're doing a wide variety of D&D, World of Darkness, just anything you could probably want. Except if you don't want to listen to me, then you're probably out of luck.
That's fair enough. Yeah, I'll put a link tree in the description for where people can find all your stuff.
Yeah, thank you so much for joining us. And
thank you for
letting
having
us
me.
Rip the guts out of your favourite film.
Yeah, I'm not thanking you for the movie.
I wouldn't have expected it, you know, going in.
Well, we would have never seen it if not for you.
No,
so...
that's an hour and 25 minutes that I'll never get back.
I'll send you the bill. It's
fine. You can find this podcast on Twitter and Instagram at Hilton Pod. That's at Hiltm Pod. We're on Discord as well. Don't bother watching this film and letting us know. It's fine.
Please never talk to us about this film ever again.
Unless you've seen it in its like original language and you genuinely think it's amazing, and then maybe we'll see if there'll be a subtitle version. No, I'm not watching that.
I'm not watching it again.
No.
I might.
I might watch it in my spare time just to know how much the American dub fucked up.
This is where at one point in the future we'll just get a message from Michael. He's like, holy shit.